Hi, I'm Louis LaCroix, commander of Baron Scribner's American Legion Post 6 here in Stevens Point, Wisconsin. I'm here with my guest, Will Lehner, a World War II veteran and a survivor of Pearl Harbor. Will, this isn't the first interview that you've been doing, and you've been doing it for quite a while.
No, Louis, I've been talking to school kids all around the state and into Minnesota, and I've been on a number of television programs, so I guess that this is kind of old thing for me, but I enjoy every time I do it, so.
Okay, let's begin then.
Okay, well, I suppose I should tell you, actually, when I got in the Navy. I was born and raised in St. Paul, Minnesota, July 19th, 1921. And at that time, I grew up in St. Paul. And when I was 17 years old, I always wanted to go to sea. And so when I was 17, I said to my dad, will you sign the papers so I can go to the Naval Reserve, go in the Naval Reserve. He says, well, what are you going to do there? And I said, well, you know, times are tough. This is 1938. And I said, it's tough to get money. It's thing we're just coming out of this depression. And I said, by belonging to the Naval Reserve, I go to practice. And we go on a cruise every year, and I said, that'd be good. I says, I get a couple extra bucks. And he said, well, okay. So he signed, and I joined in December 5th, 1938. And we went down to the practices, and we had, I think, about twice a month we used to meet. And then in the summertime, we'd take a cruise on the Great Lakes when we leave St. Paul, and we'd take the old Soo Line Railroad over to Duluth, and we'd catch an old gunboat over at Duluth, and we'd go out on the lakes for 2 weeks and do our duty and practice like we're just in the Navy. And that went along good. And you also got a few bucks, you know. So I liked it. And well, then we went on, I think I went on 1938, 39, or no, it was 39 and 40 I went on the cruises. And then 1941, January, we got called up for active duty. And of course, that was a big thing coming up with all the boys. We had 85 in our group. And our job was to go out to California and get an old World War I destroyer and hopefully put it back in commission and get ready. That was during the national emergency. So anyway, we did that. We took the old Soo Line out to California, and what a better place to be than California because of the cold weather. I think it was close to 30 below when we left Minnesota. We got out to California and took us 3 days to get out there, but got out there, and as we came into San Diego, the guys all opened the windows on the old coaches, and as we slowed down and went by the orange groves, everyone would reach out and grab an orange. That was something different for us guys. So. But anyway, we got then at San Diego destroyer base, and they checked us in there. We went and saw everything, and Then they put us aboard this old ship that was docked alongside the dock. And seemed like it was an old timer, because half the stuff was gone off of it. They had recommissioned some of the other ships, and by doing so, they had taken stuff off of this ship. So we were kind of lucky, because when they, whenever they took off, we had to get new parts. So they made new parts for the ship. So that's the way it worked out for us. Well, that was in February, February of 41, that we finally got the thing ready to go. And I think on March, we took it out for a shakedown cruise, and came back in and had a few things to do, and different parts to that we had to recondition. Finally in March, the end of March, we left for Hawaii. And at that time, anyone leaving or getting duty in Hawaii, that was really good duty. Yeah. And I always say they'd sell their soul to get back to Hawaii. And Hawaii was something. Well, anyway, we left San Francisco, went down to San Francisco, left San Francisco, and about a day out of San Francisco, we hit the worst storm that they had in the Pacific for a long time. It took us 9 days to get over to Hawaii, 2,100 miles. And at times we never thought we'd make it, because the ship was rolling so, and we were all alone. And but we finally made it, and weather cleared up, and we got into Hawaii about 9 days later.
Wow.
And we got into Pearl Harbor, and they assigned us to number 1010 dock. There was a dock there that we used to tie up to. Then we'd tie up to other docks along the backside. And anyway, there were four of us, the Allen, the Chu, the Schley, and the Ward. And that was a Hawaiian Sea Frontier division. And our job was to patrol the entrance to Pearl Harbor back and forth. And we'd take 1 week at a time. And we'd go out on Saturday morning at 7 o'clock. And that was our duty, to patrol back and forth by the entrance to Pearl. So that took care of us for almost a year, I think it was. And when we didn't have any patrolling to do, we'd probably visit some of the other islands. Mm-hmm. And so we were lucky we made all the islands in the Hawaiian chain, and had liberty at different ones, had a good time. And that was really good duty, I thought, although it was a little monotonous, because you got tired going back and forth for 7 days at 5 or 6 knots, a very slow patrol, day and night, the same old thing. And every now and then you'd run into a school of fish, and they'd drop a depth charge or two, and we'd have fish for dinner. That proceeded, took care of us for, well, the first up until November. Well, in July, I might say, back in July, there was warnings of war coming on. or of something. So then we started using ready ammunition, and we started firing the ready ammunition, the real ammunition. And we'd fire at targets out at sea, and we had maneuvers with the rest of the fleet, and we would maneuvers with submarines and have marine sound tracking and such. But in November or December 5th, we got a new skipper aboard, WW Outer Bridge, who had just come back from China. And this was his first command. He was a young lieutenant, never had command of a ship before, but he had been on some of these old destroyers. So he had some experience on destroyers. Well, he came aboard on the 6th, and the 7th of December, it was the 6th of December, we pulled out, which was a Saturday. We pulled out Saturday morning for our regular patrol. Sunday morning, about 3:30 in the morning, we got a general quarters. That's go to battle stations, which we did. And right away we thought, well, this guy is going to be a pretty tough character because he's drilling us pretty hard. And so anyway, we went to general quarters. Nothing happened. We didn't see anything. But a half hour or so later, maybe 45 minutes, we secured from general quarters, went back to sleep. Then about 6 o'clock in the morning, another general quarters. Well, we thought, boy, this guy is really going to be tough. What are we going to do with him? A new skipper, and he's training us like this on a Sunday morning. And we couldn't believe it. But anyway, at that time, we got word that someone had spotted a periscope in the area. Well, we didn't know of any submarines of our own around there, and any of our submarines had to have an escort. So we thought, well, it's just something that someone thought they saw. Well, about 6:30, we finally got word that we saw a submarine, conning tower of a submarine. And the skipper said, load all guns and be ready to fire. And anything was not supposed to be, no boats, no submarines, no ships, or anything in that area. Mm-hmm. That was restricted area. So they more or less went by that rule, and the skipper said, anything is in here, we'll shoot at it and sink it. And sure enough, they saw the conning tower coming up, and the small conning tower, we'd never seen anything like that before, but the skipper said, number one gun, fire at it, and number one gun fired, didn't have a chance. That my job was after ammunition handler. I was aft, so I didn't have anything to do other than stand and watch. And if they needed more ammunition, to get it from below and get it up to the guns. So that day, I didn't have anything to do yet. So I was watching, and I saw that submarine. It was probably out 50 or 100 yards from us. And I saw the first shell that went over the conning tower, and the water splashed. And I said, boy, that was pretty close. And then number three gun had the next chance to fire. And they said, number three gun, fire. And we were doing about 20 knots at that time. So there, that was pretty good shooting to fire that close to the conning tower. Well, the next number three gun fired at it, and they had a better shot, and they hit it right below the conning tower in the hull. And I saw it when it got hit, and it kind of waved over, bent over, the conning tower went over, and then righted itself and came straightened up again, and then it started going down. And I thought, sure, we got that. I saw it get hit, and I saw it wave, and then come back down, and then it started going down. And I was standing next to the side of the ship, and when that thing came under, it came right under the ship where I was standing, and I could see it, and I thought, geez, I never saw a submarine like that. It looked like an old rusty, what would you say, one of these culverts. It looked like it was rusty, and it wasn't very big around. It was probably 5-6 feet around, and I didn't think that we had anything like that. I had never seen anything like that before. So anyway, that went down, and as it went down, the skipper gave orders to drop depth charges. So he dropped three depth charges, I think it was, three or four depth charges. And a lot of stuff came up, but people later said, oh yeah, I saw the sub come up, but I never saw anything like that. Well, anyway, we continued our patrol. Then at shortly after that, we saw Japanese sampan, one of those fishing boats, and that was in restricted waters. So we said, well, the skipper says, well, we got to go and check on that. Maybe that had something to do with that submarine that we just sunk. And prior to that, the skipper had radioed into Pearl Harbor that we had fired upon and sunk an unidentified submarine in restricted waters. So they had the report right after we fired at it, and it went down. But we went over and investigated this sandpan, and they seemed like none of them could talk English. And skipper said, well, he said, get a boarding party. He said, we'll go aboard the ship, and he said, we'll take it in. And about that time, someone came up from down below, and he said, what is it, Captain? He could speak English just as well as you and I. And they said, well, you're not supposed to be in this restricted water. So he says, we're going to have to escort you into Honolulu Harbor. So we called the Coast Guard and told them that we had a sampan. We didn't know whose it was, but it was a sampan out there, fishing boat, in restricted waters. So they said that the Coast Guard said that they would come out and intercept it. And we started back with the sampan. And about that time, we saw a lot of commotion going on in Pearl Harbor. Planes were diving, and a lot of smoke, and we thought, well, the Army is practicing today, but why would they be practicing on a Sunday morning? You know, we couldn't imagine why they were doing that. Mm-hmm. So anyway, we came back to our normal position, and the Coast Guard had taken over escorting this sandpan in, and we back by the entrance to Pearl, and all of a sudden two planes came over us, and one on each side of us, and they came right on down and dropped bombs on each side of us and lifted the back end of the ship up, and Then we knew what it was. We could see the markings of the Japanese, the red ball on there. It's surprising they didn't hit us. They didn't strafe us. And those were the only two that came near us. And they dropped down, and that was it. And after that, they took off and went back to Pearl. But we knew then that we were at war, because that was the first indication that we had seen Japanese planes. Well, we continued our patrol back and forth, and naturally we had a lot of sound contacts, submarines or whatever, and dropped depth charges. Finally, about 1 o'clock, noon, this was about 8 o'clock that the planes came over us. And finally, about noon, we ran out of depth charges. So that meant that we had to go back into Pearl and get depth charges. So we went back into West Lock, which is the ammunition depot there. And we went back into Pearl and loaded up with some more depth charges and went back on our patrol. But that's when we saw all the damage. The ships were burning, the bodies were in the water, and water was all full of oil. Oil was burning on the water, and we didn't realize when they dropped the two bombs on us how bad it was in there. But about 1 or 2 o'clock, we saw that the damage that they had done. Mm. So we went back on our patrol, and naturally, the rest of the day was picking up sub contacts and dropping. We never got any subs or never saw any subs come up to the surface, but we did know that we were getting contacts, whether they were fish or whether they were actually sub contacts. But later on I found out but 39 or 40 years later, I found out that they had a lot of subs around there. And it could have been that we had subcontacts. But we continued our patrol, and no more Japanese. They made another raid about 9 o'clock in the morning. The first one was 8 o'clock, and the second one was about 9. And that was about the whole scope of it. Well, that night we had orders to repel any invasion force. Well, we were an old World War I destroyer with a 4-inch gun, four-inch guns, and we had a few new destroyers out there with us then in the evening. But if any invasion force would have come in, I don't think we would have been able to hold them off. But luckily for us, they didn't. So anyway, we continue that. And the next morning came and they had no invasion. Then I was back to the regular duty of patrolling for a week and then going into port for a week and maybe going out with the naval forces and doing some war maneuvers or practice. And so we had a lot of training in the next you might say the next year, because that was December of 41. And in December or January, they ordered us back to the States to have a reconstruction of the ship. They were going to make us into a fast transport. And that was a destroyer, attack destroyer transport. Mm-hmm. And we went back to Bremerton, Washington, and went into Bremerton and had our ship refigurated, you might say. They took all the torpedo tubes off. We had 12 torpedo tubes on. They took the 12 torpedo tubes off. They took the four-inch guns off. They put new Y guns on for the depth charges. They put 3-inch anti-aircraft or dual-purpose guns in place of the 4-inch. They put 20-millimeter guns on us. And so we had a pretty good armament then. And they took number 1 and 2 forward stacks off, took the boilers out, and put made troop space for us. And that was in February, I think, of 42. And March, by March we had, I think within 6 weeks, they had us all refigured and repainted, painted us green camouflage. And when we got that green camouflage, we knew what was happening then. We were going out to the South Pacific. So they loaded us up with mail for Pearl Harbor. And we took some men back to Pearl. And when we got back to Pearl, they took different people off of our ship because we didn't need the water tenders anymore because we had enough water tenders aboard with the two boilers gone and machinist mates and firemen and stuff. And they got transferred to other ships. And so we were all set to go, and it wasn't long. And we supplied, they fixed us up with supplies and loaded us up, and away we went on to the South Pacific. Well, we went out to Fiji Islands and left the, stayed one day at the Fijis, I think it was. Then from there we went, of course we had to go across the equator, and that was a big celebration because once you go across the equator, if you've never been across before, you get the initiation. You're either a polywog or a shellback, and once you're a polywog until you cross the equator, and then you're a shellback after you take the initiation. And that initiation is sometimes is quite severe. They shave your head and give you oil shampoo with the, some of this dark number four oil, which is almost like tar, and takes you a couple of weeks to get rid of all that tar in your hair, or which you don't have much of it left. But anyway. Then the next thing, we crossed the international date line, and that was another initiation. And then we got into New Caledonia and went in there and took on more supplies and stayed there, I think, about 2 days. And after that, it was ship us down to Guadalcanal. And Guadalcanal was just in the infancy then. They had a lot of sea battles there at Savo Island. And we got into, luckily we didn't get into any of the big sea battles, but we had a lot of ships that were sunk there, cruisers and aircraft carriers. And our job was to pick up troops and jump to the next island after Guadalcanal was secured. And so we did that, and we were based at Guadalcanal for the next 13 months. And then after 13 months, I think we came back to New Caledonia, and we went into dry dock, and they inspected the ship there. That was about, that must have been 6 months or 13 months later, I guess it was. I thought it was 6 months, but I think we were there for 13 months before we finally got back to New Caledonia. But anyway, we got back there, and they put us in dry dock, and the guys were a little dismayed and not too happy about being up at Guadalcanal so long. And when we got into New Caledonia, they put us in dry dock, and we had to do chip and paint on the bottom of the ships. And some of the guys were pretty over energetic, and they put a chip and hammer through the side of the ship. And there were inspectors there, and they said, this ship is not seaworthy, so we'll patch it up and we'll send you back to the States. And the skipper heard about that, and he said, listen, we came out here to fight this war. We didn't come out here to go back to the States. And he says, well, all right, if that's the way you feel, then we'll patch you up and paint the bottom of the ship up. And as soon as that's done, back to Guadalcanal. So that's when we went back to Guadalcanal, and then we stayed there until Guadalcanal was secured, and all the other islands up there that we made. We made Monda, we made New Georgia, we made Columbagera, and everyone in the line. We made all the landings up there. And finally, after all the landings, they said, well, you guys are ready for a little R&R. So they sent us back to New Caledonia, New Mayo, New Caledonia. And we got orders to go to Sydney, Australia. We went to Sydney, Australia, and we spent 10 days leave in Sydney. And, that was a good vacation for us. After the 10 days, we got supplied up again, and away we went and came back. And instead of coming back to New Caledonia, we went right to New Guinea. And that was our job then. We started at Buna in New Guinea, and started the push to the Philippines. So we started making one landing, and then another landing, and then another landing, and then another landing. And we kept making landings all the way from there, all the way to, I'm trying to think of the place that we were, but Hollandia, that was the last big push in New Guinea, and then they got a big base started there in New Guinea. So then we made landings from Hollandia on up to the smaller islands. And finally in 1943, first part of 43, I think it was. We got ready for the landing in the Philippines, and went to the. Our job was naturally to land the assault troops. We had the first wave of everything whenever we went into a landing. We went into Dinagat, which was a small island just outside of Leyte. And that was supposed to be a headquarters for the Japanese at that time. So we made a landing there with underwater demolition team, and also with clearing the mines. We were to clear the mines and also army troops to take over that island. And we got that secured, but we ran into a big typhoon at that time. So we lost one boat, went ashore, couldn't get back off. The boat was damaged. And we had to up anchor and ride out the storm that night. And we finally got three of our boats back. And that was the 17th of October, I think it was, before the big force came in. The big force came in on the 20th of October, and 1943, and 43 or 44, I can't remember. It's so long ago that, but I've got 44, 43, yeah, and we made all those landings, and at 44 that was, we made landings at Atapi, Sador, Bayak, Cape Ganzapor, Sansapor, Moratai Island in 44, and the big landing was Dinagat was October 17th, 44. So I was just a year off. But then we went back to Hollandia after that landing and picked up more troops and shuttled them back to the Philippines. And that was our job from then on, back and forth to the Philippines. And finally in December or November of November of 44, we left Hollandia with some more troops and went up to Leyte, and then we were stationed out of Leyte from then on. And that was in November. So then we made back and forth, we made landings or made trips back and forth to New Guinea, bringing troops back and forth from November into December. And December 6th, we made a trip to go to Ormoc Bay. And we left on Saturday night, I think it was the 6th of December, Saturday night. And if it was, probably wasn't Saturday night, but left the 6th of December and went to Ormoc Bay. And then the 7th of December, we landed troops at Ormoc Bay, 9 o'clock in the morning. 9 o'clock, we had all our troops off. And then we were to screen and look for submarines and screen for the other ships. And about 10 o'clock in the morning, big Japanese force came in, and they had 11 transports that they were landing troops at Ormoc. We had landed behind the Japs to cut them off from our troops, and the Japanese were landing troops to reinforce that bunch. So, and along with that, they had a lot of air cover. So anyway, with the air cover, they had big twin engine bombers and Zeros coming in. But we saw planes coming in, and we were just cruising back and forth, screening for these other ships for submarine detection, picking up subs, or if we could, we never picked up anything. But That was about the time that we saw about six or eight big twin engine bombers come over. They flew right over us and went over to the beach to bomb. And then they picked out different ships and dove into them, kamikazes. And we saw one destroyer that got hit. It dove right down, straight down into it. And we saw the big explosion. That was probably about a half a mile away from us at the time. And then after that, they figured that they would come over and check us out. So three of them came down on us. And my duty was, I was first loader on number four gun, which was aft. And what they would usually do is they'd come down on the aft end of the stern of the ship, and they'd try and come down there, and they'd crash land on the deck, and they'd slide along the deck and kill as many people as they could. Well, they came down on us on the tail end, and three of those twin engines came down. We shot two of them down, and the third one kind of veered away from us, and the skipper was zigzagging the ship at the time, so he was watching the ship or watching the planes and watching, trying to get away from them, and that one plane took off and came into the side of the ship and hit us right in the right where the troops were, right below deck, right where the forward, well, aft of the bridge, just aft of the bridge. And she went right in and exploded inside the ship, and one motor came off and flew out the other side of the ship, and we of course had a big fire in there then, and we couldn't do anything about the fire. We tried putting it out, we couldn't put it out, and there were about six of us that went down and got off the gun. I got off the gun and went down, tried to help put out the fire. There were about six of us, and finally the skipper said, "Abandon ship. We're gonna take off. We're gonna leave the ship. And we can't save it." And so we were still fighting the fire, the six of us, and the skipper came alongside, and he was in a boat and going to another ship, and he said, "What are you guys doing here?" And we said, "We're trying to save our home." And he says, "I told you, abandon ship, and I mean it." He says, "This is the last boat that's going." So he says, "There's one boat more right down here." And he says, "I want you to get in it and get off the ship right now." So we got off, I got off, and they took me to another ship. And I never even hit the water. Went to the screw guard in the back and stepped on the screw guard, and from the screw guard right into the boat. And so they took me to another ship, and they had about three of us on that boat, and there were three of them on the other boat that went with the skipper. And anyway, they continued that. Planes were all over, and I thought that we were going to get sunk in the second ship that I went on. And he missed and dove into the water, and so that about took care of it. But that day, our ships and our Air Force shot down over 99 planes. Wow. That they had. And it so happened that Major Bong, who was an ace, was there at that time. And shortly after that, I found out that they transferred him back to the States, and it wasn't long after that that he got killed in a test. He was test pilot then, and he got killed in one of the first jet planes that they were testing. So, but then they took us back to Leyte, and after Leyte, I was to go back to. We all had to go back to Hollandia, and they took us back by different ships, and we all met back in Hollandia. And back in Hollandia, we all got together, the group all got together, and then they issued us new clothes and a Bible or whatever shoes and that we needed. And I had my own shoes, and most of the guys had their shoes, but they only had what they were wearing when the ship went down. So, and then they shipped us back to San Francisco, and went back to San Francisco. We got back to San Francisco, I think it was 31st of December. Something like that, either the first of the year or the middle of January, got back to San Francisco. And we went to Treasure Island, naval base there, and I was transferred to the hospital, naval hospital in Oakland, and there were a couple other guys from my ship that were transferred to Oakland. Some of the other guys were transferred to, had leave to go home, and when they got back, then they went to new ships or went to other ships. And so I spent 5.5 months in Oakland Hospital, and then that was in 1945, because we got sunk December 7th, 1944, 3 years to the day after Pearl. And so that was 45 already, and the war was kind of slowing down. We had the upper hand then. And they didn't want a lot of the enlisted men that had high ranks, and I was acting chief at the time, and so they thought it'd be better to get rid of me. So they gave me a medical discharge, but I had almost 8 years, so, and I wanted to stay in because I was already acting chief, and I would have made chief, and then I would have had a pretty good start on my career.
Yeah.
But anyway, they sent me back home in August of 44, and when I got back home, I thought, well, what am I going to do now? And then in September, the war was over, and so I decided that, hey, I better get a job. So I got a job and went to work, and I had a number of different jobs that I worked on, and I worked on the railroad, St. Paul to Seattle. I was second cook there, and that didn't go too well with my fiance because I was gone from Tuesday until Saturday and Sunday, and then I'd go out again Tuesday. So that didn't go very good. So after that, I did sales work for a while, and finally I thought, well, the best thing for me is to go and go to school. So then I went to, I signed up at Dunwoody Institute, which is a college, industrial college, and I went to industrial college there and graduated from there. Then I finished that job and I went to, after I finished that schooling, then I went on a job, and I was a printer, and so I was a printer for Well, I was printer here in Stevens Point. I came here in 1949, and I was working at the Worth Company for a while, which is now Spectra Print. And then I worked, at the Worth Company, but I worked at Valley Sales, which was Spectra Print. And then I went to work for the Worth Company. And I worked there for 32 and a half years and finally retired in 1986. And I've been retired since then. This is 20 some years. So yeah. I had a pretty good time of it. And, I don't know if we're going to continue this or not. It kind of ends my career on the ship, but I've got other things that I could tell you about later on. I've had interviews with the History Channel. I've had interviews with the Discovery Channel. I've had interviews with National Geographic, and they've done documentaries, and so they've all done a lot of different documentaries on the sinking of the submarine, an hour and 20 minutes before the attack. But I just got through with an interview out in California in November that has to do with the last of the five midget subs that were sent over by Japan. And they've got track of four of them, and they think that they found the fifth one. And I'm supposed to go to Hawaii in February and do another documentary on that fifth submarine. So I'm looking forward to that. It's a short time from now, and hopefully they'll be able to take me over there. Right now, it's undecided when they're going to do it. First, it was January, and now it's pushed up to February, and they've had trouble with the ship that takes the two submersibles out there. So I talked to Terry Kirby, who operates the submersible, and I think I talked to him about 2 weeks ago, and he said that the ship was supposed to go in for repairs this past Friday. And if that's the case, and they get it done in time, then they'll have the schedule the same as the 8th of February I plan on leaving. So not knowing what to do, I'm just sitting tight and hoping that everything will go along good. But
Are they thinking of raising that sub?
No, they'll never raise that sub.
Okay.
That's down there. The two men were still in there. And I had a chance to go down in a submersible and with the University of Hawaii and see that sub. We went down 1,200 feet down in a submersible, and we were down for about 3.5 hours. So, and that was the best thing that ever happened for me, because to get down there and look out the porthole and see that sub and see the hole where we hit it with the 4-inch gun, that was really great. And hopefully, I thought that I might be able to go down in the submersible this time, but they told me ahead of time that, no, you've been down once, and it only holds three people. So we can't let you go down. We got other people that want to go down and see that. Now this is a this is what they think the fifth submarine that they found, and it's in pieces, so they don't know whether or not it's the right one. But that's the reason that they're going over to photograph that and get more information on it. So I'm anxious to go, but whether or not they'll let me is another thing. So, I don't know if they're going to continue this. I got nothing more to say on this part.
I'm sure that we'll be having other interviews, and we'd love to have you back to continue with more information that may have.
I could tell you about my trip with National Geographic when we went looking for that sub. I went with Bob Ballard, who found the Titanic,
right.
and then I was with the History Channel, and then I was with Discovery Channel when I went down in the sub, and when the university found the sub. Ballard never got to find that sub, so but that's about it. But that'd be fine. I'd be willing to come back any time.
Okay.
And if I could, I'd dwell on the time when I went with Bob Ballard.
Sure.
And I could tell you about the time when I went down with Discovery Channel also. So whatever is best for this.
Well, we definitely will be getting in touch with you.
Yeah.
And Will, I want to thank you very much for being here and for your presentation. And we look forward to doing this again.
Well, I enjoyed it. I'm getting so that I enjoy getting before the camera. So,
a regular celebrity.
Well, I'm not a celebrity. I'm just lucky that I'm alive.
Yeah. Well,
but thank you very much.
You're quite welcome. And I would like to thank you all for watching this program, and a special thanks to the Community Television for helping make this program possible. Thank you, and good day.